Good morning and welcome to this morning's meeting. We have got, this is our fourth meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. And Paul O'Kane has sent his apologies for this meeting and we'd like to welcome back Jackie Bailey, who's attending as a substitute member on the committee. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. We are agreed. And our second item today is an evidence session with the Scottish Government as part of our inquiry into health and well-being of children and young people. And I'm delighted to welcome to the committee this morning Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, and Marie Todd, the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport. And they're joined online by their officials, Angela Davison, Acting Deputy Director for Improving Mental Health and Wellbeing, Mary McPherson, Deputy Director for Improving Health and Wellbeing, Directorate for Children and Families, Stephen McLeod, National Advisor for CAMHS and Neurodevelopmental Services, and Carolyn Wilson, the Policy Advisor for Children and Families. So welcome to you all and welcome to the Ministers. Ms Todd, I believe that you've got an opening statement you'd like to make.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to assist the committee with this inquiry into health and the health and wellbeing of children and young people in Scotland. I'd like to thank everyone who responded to the inquiry, either in writing or in person. As has been noted, the impact that poverty, challenging family circumstances and the pandemic has had on babies, children and young people cannot be underestimated. I'd like to pay tribute here to our young people who throughout the pandemic have been extremely gracious in the way they've responded to the curtailing of their everyday lives. But we know that that impact is already being seen in children's speech and language skills, the increase in being at risk of being overweight or obesity and mental wellbeing. As decision makers, we need to make sure that we do all we can to ensure that they have the right support at the right time so that they can flourish. Early identification is key, and our universal services are at the forefront of our efforts to tackle these issues before they become long-term problems. We don't want the adults of tomorrow dependent on acute healthcare because of issues they face as children today. We need to turn off that tap now so that the effects are not seen downstream in the future. And that's why our health visiting service plays a vital role in helping babies and children thrive through the first 5 years. A health visitor following the evidence-based universal health visiting pathway, meeting children and their families in their own homes, is a trusted source of support and knowledge for families. By picking up issues early, a platform for children's health and wellbeing is set which takes them through to adulthood. Every part of government has a role in tackling the challenges that impact on children's health, and children and young people are one of our national priorities in the National Performance Framework. That's because we know that every part of government and society needs our children to achieve the best physical and mental health and wellbeing possible. We need to ensure that protecting and promoting children's rights are at the heart of all that we do. Good health and wellbeing is more than simply the absence of illness. It makes learning easier, future life choices wider. It makes an active and enjoyable life more likely. It's therefore paramount that early identification of need and responsive high-quality supports are available to meet that need. We know that the COVID-19 period has been exceptionally difficult for the mental health and well-being of many children, young people and their families. And we've been working directly with children, young people, parents and carers to develop policies to address this. As a government, we're making significant investments in our mental health services to encourage recovery and renewal as we emerge from the COVID-19 pandemic. We recognise how important it is for children and young people to be able to access mental health and wellbeing support at the earliest possible stage, which is why early intervention is such a key focus of our mental health and wellbeing transition and recovery plan, and why children and young people's focused activities make up a large proportion of the £120 million recovery fund which supports the plan. We've provided funding to a range of children and young people's organisations, creating a suite of online resources, information and advice to support the emotional health and well-being of children and young people. Young people and families have also told us that they need more support for mental and emotional distress and support for their well-being and resilience delivered in a community setting. Therefore, this financial year, we have provided local authorities with an additional £15 million to fund over 230 new and enhanced supports and services for children and young people. And we're providing an additional £15 million in 2022-23 to fund the continuation of these services. Every baby, child or young person in Scotland has the right to the best possible physical and mental health, and I look forward to the outcome of your inquiry as we continue to work to improve the outcomes for babies, children and young people to enable them to reach their full potential. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Todd. And I think you've outlined how the wellbeing of children and young people is a priority for the government. And we echo that in this committee, and that's why we're doing this inquiry, because it's a priority for us too. And certainly the evidence that we've heard, particularly as a result of COVID, is that it should be a priority for us. Now, it's the priority for policymakers, and you've outlined how it cuts across government. Well, on the ground, as we look at those implementing the policies that the government has throughout Scotland, like in local authority areas, health board areas, how does the government, and it's a question for both of you, how does the government ensure that on the ground it's also a priority and that what you want to see happening is actually getting to people on the ground? So if we maybe come to Kevin Stewart, first of all, from the mental health perspective.
Convener, obviously we want to track what is happening on the ground to ensure that the investment that we are making is actually making a real difference to young people and their families. Ms Todd talked about the £15 million of investment to local authorities. We know that some local authorities have responded quicker than others in terms of utilising those resources. We know that others are taking longer and we need to ensure that they speed up. And beyond that, that they recognise that the monies that we have made available here will flow into the next year. So there is the comfort of them knowing that that resourcing is there. And, you know, I think all of us, all of our expectations, is that that money is best utilised for the good of children in every area. I think the other aspect of tracking outcomes, convener, is looking at the data that is currently available to us, but also looking to see what changes we need to make. So, for example, we have the annual health and wellbeing census that the government uses a number of resources to track the wellbeing of young people. But we need to go beyond that, and the pandemic has learned us some lessons there. So during the pandemic, the support, for example, that we provided to Young Scot to undertake the lockdown lowdown survey provided us with useful insights into the particular impacts that the pandemic and associated restrictions had on children and young people. And then this year we'll be commissioning an independent evaluation of our children and young people community wellbeing supports and services, ensuring that we're listening to the voices of those using and seeking access to those services. So those are the kind of things that we need to do. We need to listen to the voices of lived experience to see what is working, and we need to track to ensure that the resourcing that we are making available is actually getting it right for young people.
Ms Todd.
So I think the best way for me to answer your question is to talk about two particular programmes. So if I talk firstly about the Universal Health Visiting Programme, which is a universal service available to everyone, and then the more targeted family nurse partnership. So at the start of the pandemic, all of our services pivoted to digital response, face-to-face visiting was reduced. But recognising the importance to new parents of the health visiting service, new parents and babies were prioritised at that time of national emergency, and national clinical guidance was produced by Scottish Government right at the start of the pandemic, March 2020, to ask the health visiting services to prioritise visits for new babies. And that's the first visit at 10 days and the 6 to 8 week check. That guidance was adapted throughout the pandemic, so time and time again we asked for babies and children to be prioritised. Health visitors largely remained in post. They weren't redeployed to other parts of the response. And that was monitored closely by government. So over the first 6 months of the pandemic, health boards reported regularly into Scottish Government where data around the health visitor check. So you can see that during the pandemic, we did keep an eye, we did give instructions and guidance on what we expected to happen, and we made sure that that did happen, as well as that check during the emergency situation. Our regular child health surveillance programme continued during the pandemic, so we did collect our usual data on that. The child health reviews were carried out throughout the pandemic. And some of those contacts might have been virtual, it might have looked a little different on the ground, it might have felt a little different to families, but that contact was still there. And there's very little difference in the, you know, shown in the data in terms of the percentage of reviews carried out at first visit, 6 to 8 weeks, 13 to 15 months, 27 to 30 months, and 4 to 5 years compared to the pre-pandemic level. As well as that, I mean, the Universal Health Visiting Pathway, we have a programme in place to evaluate it. So we don't just ask health boards to implement that Universal Health Visiting Pathway and leave them to it. We look at not just whether it's happening, but also whether it's having the impact that we want it to have, because we want it to make a difference. So that main phase one evaluation report's been published in December last year, and the Scottish Government accepts those findings in full and is pretty keen to build on the recommendation, consider the recommendations in the report and identify appropriate next steps. If we look at the Family Nurse Partnership, the Family Nurse Partnership is a targeted support. Again, it's aimed at young people who have children under the age of 19. There are some people who are eligible for it up to the age of 24, and it provides a holistic support from early in pregnancy right the way through to when the child is 2 years old. It's an evidence-based programme, so we know what we're anticipating to achieve with that programme, and we go looking to see that it's had that impact. That was also prioritised throughout the pandemic, and including home visits, because these were more vulnerable families, so home visits were prioritised for that programme. Again, we collected data to ensure that that was happening. Across Scotland, around 3,000 families are supported by the Family Nurse Partnership at any one time, and over 10,000 families have received that programme over the past 10 years, with over 6,000 families graduating from the programme. So we do collect a lot of data, we don't leave it to chance, and we are continually trying to improve. I mean, Scotland is recognised around the world as having some of the best quality improvement methodology built in to our NHS services anywhere in the world. We are continually striving to improve what we deliver to families to meet their health needs.
I want to come back to Mr. Stewart, particularly, obviously, your portfolio's got the National Care Service development in it, and children's health and wellbeing services are anticipated to fall within the remit of the National Care Service when it's developed and implemented. What are the opportunities there for that joined-up approach that we've all been discussing already this morning has been a priority with having it in the National Care Service?
Well, first of all, Convener, I should say that we are still analysing the responses that we have to the consultation. But we know that we have got more work to do in terms of consulting with stakeholders around about our proposals before final decisions are taken by the Cabinet. But in all of this, in all of the work that we are doing, in terms of National Care Service, whether services are in or out of the National Care Service. We have to ensure that we are taking that joined-up approach. We know all too well from stakeholders that sometimes transition periods are some of the most difficult times for people. And there doesn't seem to be that link that there should be in terms of moving from one service to another. Now, the question is, and, you know, we have obviously changed legislation in recent times around about this, what is the right time anyway for that change? And is that change actually the right thing to do? So much more joined up approaches are required. And I think if I can maybe give you an example of where sometimes, you know, we don't get it right and we actually can confuse people and do too much rather than have a systematic right approach for folks. One of my officials was talking to a young person the other week, and I think this is the starkest example that I can give, where a lot of things going on in that young person's life, and there are 15 different agencies involved in that young person's life at this moment. And the question that that young person asked was, who do I listen to in all of this? Because often what that person was being told was contradictory according to them. Now, I think, you know, convener, that I think we could all agree is not the right way for a young person. So we have to ensure, as we move forward, that we don't have those kind of examples, and yet that, you know, that everything that we do is person-centred. And with a lot of young folk, the message that I've been getting is, I want somebody to deal with me that I can trust. And, you know, there is absolutely no reason why the good practice that is going on in many places of that lead person cannot be done right across the board. And that's where, you know, again, whether children's services are in or out of National Care Service, and, you know, the initial responses show that the majority are in favour of children's services being in National Care Service. But no matter what, we have to make sure that those linkages are absolutely right, and that we are taking that person-centred approach rather than the current situation where we do have, in some cases, a bit of a postcode lottery. So no matter what, national quality standards so that folks know the service that they can expect. And beyond that, for me, in all of this, again, no matter what, we have to listen to the voices of lived experience. The places where services are working well are the ones where young folk are at the heart of helping shape services, where there is the ultimate amount of communication, collaboration and cooperation. And no matter what, that's what we need to see across the board.
Thank you. We'll move on to my colleagues. Emma Harper, you've got some questions around public health priorities.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Good morning to both ministers. I can see Kevin Stewart there. I'm interested in some of the public health priorities that we have. And priority number two is states that we have a Scotland where we flourish in our early years. So I'd be interested to know, I think it would be Marie Todd, that how do we measure the or monitor and evaluate how we have a Scotland where our young people are flourishing?
So that's a really good question, because one of the most important measures, I guess, or one of the really important measures is a very long-term one. It's how people flourish into adulthood, isn't it? So it is difficult to measure these very long-term investments. Certainly when I was Minister for Children and Young People, we looked at the investment that went into 1140 hours, one of the biggest social infrastructure investments that this government has ever made. And what we expected from that was a transformation, a transformative opportunity for 3 and 4 year olds who would be the quality of education offered to them at that stage would enable them not only to thrive at that stage, but to seize the opportunities that they were offered higher up in school. There is evidence from other countries that if you deliver high quality early learning and childcare, which we strive to do in Scotland, that you will actually see a benefit not just at the time that child is in education and in early life, but also right through to their own early adulthood, and a measurable difference in their parenting quality. So some of these investments are very long term. It truly is. I mean, I would take 1140 hours as truly being one of the greatest long-term investments that we have made in our children in order to enable them to thrive. How do we measure it? Well, we have evaluation programmes in place to measure the short-term impacts. It is difficult to have, you know, to grasp those long-term impacts. You know, those children have not experienced 1140 hours, for example, for an entire generation yet. So it becomes more challenging to measure the long-term outcomes, but we do keep an eye on a lot of short-term data. We collect data on all sorts of measures that we think will have an impact. So, for example, breastfeeding rates. We recognise that breastfeeding is a really important public health intervention. Breastfeeding is the best kind of food for infants and children, and we want to support women to breastfeed where they want to make that decision. And we've seen breastfeeding rates increase. So the family nurse programme, we've seen breastfeeding rates increase in that particular population because of that intervention. And across the board in the population, we've seen at the moment, at this moment in time, the highest rates of breastfeeding we've ever had in Scotland. And we've started to see a closing of that gap that exists in terms of socioeconomic gap, in terms of high rates of breastfeeding in more wealthy areas and lower rates of breastfeeding in areas where there's more poverty. We've started to see that gap close, though the inequality gap is closing. So like I say, we do monitor very closely data and collect lots and lots of data on how things are going, but from a public health perspective, there are two challenges in that. One, you're looking for very long-term effects. And two, there are all sorts of other things that can skew what happens. So if you look at over the last 10 years, we have made a huge amount of effort in improving the situation for our children and young people. We've introduced all sorts of programmes that will support them to flourish. But we've also had a Westminster government that's pursued an agenda of austerity. We've had a Westminster government that's pursued an agenda of welfare reform. We have outside agencies outside of the UK looking at the level of poverty in the UK, saying that the welfare reform has particularly targeted disabled people. It has particularly, it has made poverty worse for children. We have a two-child cap, for heaven's sake. We have children growing up in Scotland who are entitled, we would say, to support from the state because they are living in poverty. And we have a Westminster government that pursues a policy which says that they cannot have support because they have two or more brothers and sisters. So there are real challenges in terms of gathering data and ensuring that the interventions that you are making are having the outcome that you desire. Firstly, because of the long-term nature of this work, and secondly, because of the impact of processes right across government, and not just this government, processes from the Westminster government as well, all have an impact.
1140 hours of childcare, that would be delivered by local authorities. So can you explain what is the Scottish Government doing to help local authorities or other public organisations to help deliver a Scotland where our young people flourish?
Minister for Children and Young People next week as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would, passionate I am about 1140 hours. I think it's probably best I do leave that to Claire Hawkey. But there are programmes. I mean, things like the Universal Health Visiting Pathway really does make a difference, and we're starting to see that measurable difference. And that's early years interventions which are making a difference to very young children in Scotland. And that difference, we know that those very earliest years are the most important. That's where governments get the biggest, let me say, bang for their buck. The investment delivers the greatest results. That is also, I mean, when I talk about some of the impacts of poverty, the reason it is so urgent is because that is also where it has the most devastating and lifelong impact. If a child under five is living in poverty, it will have a lifelong impact on their health and well-being, and we need to strive to tackle that.
I wonder if I could add something, and I won't stray into the education in early years, although it's tempting, but I know that you've got Shona Robeson and Claire Hawkey next week. But I think one of those other areas which can make a real difference is the investment that we have made into perinatal and infant mental health. And I know that you have been discussing that as a committee, and you will report very soon. But that four-year investment makes a substantial contribution to improving and supporting mental health and well-being of women and infants. And, you know, I think that that in itself can make a huge long-term impact in the future. And we await your report and recommendations with some anticipation.
Emma, okay. Do you want to follow up on that?
Yeah, I'll just quickly touch on, I won't go too deep into poverty and disability, and you've mentioned that the austerity policies by the UK government have caused that. But can I touch a wee bit on adverse childhood experiences and how that can adversely affect health outcomes, and also link that with eating disorders? For instance, we've seen an increase in eating disorders during the pandemic, and that's something that I'm interested in. So it would be interesting to hear if we talk about adverse childhood experiences and how that affects children growing up, but also touch on the work that's happening as far as addressing eating disorders, because, again, we have seen that increase during the pandemic.
If you don't mind, I'll start and set out what we have available universally to tackle adverse childhood experiences, and my colleague Kevin Stewart will pick up on the specific points you raise about eating disorders. But preventing and responding to early adversity and trauma is absolutely central to the getting it right for every child approach, which Kevin Stewart was talking about earlier, that multidisciplinary collaborative, putting the services around the child and working together. So GERFIC, we call it, that's the acronym that we use, but it stands for Getting It Right for Every Child. And some examples of that type of thing, I mean, obviously, Shona Robeson will talk more about this next week, but we're trying to increase family incomes and reduce living costs through the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. Improving the early learning and childcare system is part of that. So you see how all these different programmes come together. You know, that the 1140 hours investment will support children who are experiencing poverty. It will ensure that they get high quality interactions and learning. But it also supports their parents in order to be able to work and learn. We're investing in perinatal and infant mental health to support parents and infants, as Mr. Stewart said, you know, early on, preventing any problems from escalating. And we're also providing more support for children and families in the very earliest years, as I've set out. So the health visiting programme, Universal Health Visiting Service is one of them, the rollout of family nurse partnerships. We're continuing that effort to improve the offering right the way up through ages. So we're doing a lot of work in school nurses at the moment to ensure that school nurses are focused on tackling adversity. And you're right, that understanding that early childhood adversity has an impact not just on the mental health, which is, you know, that was always kind of obvious that your early years would have an impact on your later mental health. But what the ACEs studies gave us was an understanding of the physical impact of early childhood adversity. These children who experience multiple adversities in childhood die younger. So this is why, you know, my job in public health, trying to increase life expectancy, starts decades before trying to improve the living environment for children and young people.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, and I'll maybe finish off on some of the aspects that Ms. Todd has touched upon there, because I think there are a number of other things that we need to do. We need to raise awareness about adverse childhood experiences in our communities and across the nation. And, you know, we have to recognise the impact that trauma can have on people. And that's why, you know, we are investing in our national trauma training programme some £4 million to support the development of trauma-informed workforces and services. And I have to say that in some parts of the country, there's some trailblazing work going on at this moment. I had the pleasure of talking to folks from South Ayrshire and Dundee recently, and very, very impressed with the work that's going on in South Ayrshire and how that local authority in particular has done such a huge amount with its workforce, but also with elected members around about trauma-informed practice. And I think that that kind of work, we have to ensure that is exported right across the board. If I could turn to eating disorders, because Ms. Harper asked around about that. And eating disorder services are extremely important to me, because I have knowledge, as folk know, of people that I know that have been impacted by family members who have had eating disorders. And I have to say that during the course of the pandemic period, eating disorder cases have risen. And we have to continue to monitor and react to that as we move forward. We have put in place, as folks know, the National Review of Eating Disorder Services. That group is jointly chaired by Dennis Robertson, former MSP, who has campaigned vociferously for improved eating disorder services. And along with him, Dr. Charlotte Oakley, who was previously the clinical lead of Connect Eating Disorders in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, is the co-chair of that national review. And the aim for the group is to ensure that stakeholders, through collaboration and engagement, are empowered to provide their input, experience and expertise to play a leading role in the delivery of the recommendations that were made and to improve services. Convener, I'm sure the committee is very well aware that we announced in June an additional £5 million to respond to the recommendations of the review. And we have also put further investment into some of the third sector organisations, £400,000, to beat the UK's eating disorder charity, to provide a wider range of options and support for families and carers, as well as those affected by eating disorders. As I said, and you know, I don't think we can underplay this, there has been an increase in the amount of folk presenting with eating disorders. We have a fair amount of work to do here in order to get it right for folks as we move forward.
Thank you. Can I bring in Evelyn Tweed on this issue? Not that issue, but you want to talk about sport, I believe?
Yes. Yeah. Thanks, Convener. What steps is the Scottish Government... and good morning, Ministers. What steps is the Scottish Government taking to ensure all children and young people can eat well, have a healthy weight and can be physically active?
Thanks very much. That's an excellent and timely question, because what we're seeing in the early data as we come out of this pandemic is an alarming increase in the levels of childhood obesity. And it was always, you know, it's been an increasing challenge for us over the last few years, even before the pandemic. But we've seen some worrying statistics last year of children entering primary one at higher weights than ever before, a big increase. So despite the fact that we prioritise sport and physical activity for children throughout the pandemic. So we've set some challenging targets pre-pandemic to significantly to tackle childhood obesity and to significantly reduce diet-related health inequalities. I think we are undoubtedly going to have to look at that programme in detail and ensure that we are achieving what we want to achieve. We want to make it easier for people to make healthy choices and to reduce the health harm caused by diet and healthy weight. It is a complex problem, though, so we are, you know, there's not like a single one-size-fits-all answer that you can just pick off the shelf and make a difference. We're going to have to do multiple things. We're going to have to start looking at this problem before children are even conceived, so looking at the health of women. We're going to have to support women during the antenatal period and support children from birth right up to starting school. We've got a number of programmes to tackle obesity in general, so things like we've got some extra money, extra £2 million to improve weight management services for children and young people going into the system at the moment. We introduced new school food regulations to make school food and drink even healthier. I talked about the work that we're doing to improve the rates of breastfeeding. And of course, breastfeeding is linked, the more breastfeeding there is, the lower the risk of obesity. And we're looking at food labelling, particularly infant food labelling, because quite often there are health claims made on infant foods which are incorrect, and you know, foods sold as snacks and you know, treat snacks. Babies don't need biscuits, frankly. So we've got a multi-pronged approach to tackling and improving the diet of our children and young people. You're right, we need to increase physical activity, and I am absolutely passionate about that. But you can't, you know, experts tell me time and time again, you can't outrun a bad diet, so we need to do both. We need to be tackling the diet as well as the increase in physical activity. Increased physical activity will help people's, you know, children and young people's physical health. It will also help their mental health. And we've a solid body of evidence pointing in that direction now. It's also fun. Children learn through play and outdoor, you know, getting outdoors. Each and every one of us will know that getting outdoors and exercising was one of the best ways to cope with the absolutely challenging situation that we've been in for the last couple of years. It's no different for children. They need to get outdoors and let off steam, and we need to create more and more opportunities to do that. And as I say, that's a real focus for our early years.
I've got a long list of my colleagues that want to come in specifically on physical activity.
Absolutely, I've got loads to say on it, so I'll stop and let you guys ask some questions.
I know how passionate you are about physical activity, and we see your daily mile is testament
to
that.
I've done my daily mile this morning.
But we've got, I mean, just there's a few members, and just to let members know that I have got you on the list. So we've got Stephanie, Sue, Sandesh and Kyle all want to ask questions around healthy weight and physical activity. Can I bring in Stephanie first of all?
Not physical activity, if you want to take the others first.
Yeah, okay, well, I'll take Sue.
Thank you, convener. Yes, I'm very passionate as well about sport and physical activity, and particularly team sports for me, but because I'm a real believer that that helps people out of some socially deprived situations and gives them a great springboard for going forward. So what is the Scottish Government's assessment of the impact the pandemic has had on physical activity levels within children and their ability to access sport or varying and other activities?
So first of all, let me say I absolutely agree with you about the impact of team sports, and actually the evidence would, you know, it's intuitive, but the evidence would support that. So we're seeing with some particular, I think it was work in Wales done around adverse childhood experiences, that participating in team sports mitigates and that benefit lasts right into adulthood. So again, if you're looking for a benefit that has a long-lasting impact, encouraging team sports is definitely an important thing to do. There is no doubt the opportunities to be physically active were prioritised throughout the restrictions, but they were restricted. Even just, you know, not being at school. So not walking to and from school will have had an impact on many children. I think that much of the reason why children and, in fact, you know, many of us in the population gained weight was because we weren't out and about exercising without, you know, the exercise that we do every day that we don't even realise is exercise. You know, they're just getting from A to B. So because there were significant restrictions in how much we were out and about, but as well as that in sport and physical activity, I think, and, you know, reduced active travel, we're seeing an impact. The impact is likely to have been felt unequally. So our early understanding, as is the case in almost every situation, people in more deprived communities suffered more. So that's probably about not having access to green spaces or a garden. So being holed up in a flat, it was a very different prospect to being holed up in a detached house with a large garden. We did, our sports clubs and our governing bodies have been incredibly supportive in the recovery. So we've seen, actually, even during the midst of the pandemic, we saw some of our sport clubs in communities absolutely being a huge part of the response to the pandemic and reaching out and supporting their communities and playing a key and pivotal role. And they've continued to play that key and pivotal role. It's been easier for outdoor sports to recover than indoor sports. And that's just the way this virus operates. And it is, you know, safer to gather together outdoors than it is to gather indoors. So we've seen huge increases in participation and actually, you know, waiting lists in football, in rugby, in most of the outdoor team sports have recovered pretty well. The indoor sports have had a tougher time, and the need to further restrict indoor sports for adults, admittedly, over the course of the Omicron spike has made it difficult for them as well. We absolutely recognise how important it is to be physically active, and I guess that's why we've prioritised it throughout the pandemic. But despite our best efforts, there has been an impact.
Members who've asked to come in this particular theme. Carol, did you want to come in physical activity?
Can I maybe come in the team aspect?
Sure.
Okay,
can you? Sure, and then I'll come to Carol, who's got a question.
Because I think Ms. Weber makes an excellent point around about team activity. And during the first lockdown, which was very difficult for young folks, I know that some teams coped by being able to gather online. And I had a discussion with Paul McNeil, who's the excellent head of community development at the SFA, at an event that I was at St Mirren, which I've talked about before to the committee. And he was saying one of the teams that he coached, you know, the kids were getting on grand online. Those folks that couldn't get online, it was a much more difficult experience for them mentally, because they weren't able to connect with their teammates. And that's why it was so important that we made that investment in terms of getting digital devices out there to those folks that were digitally excluded. Because I think the team aspect actually seen a lot of folk through here. And I don't think we can underemphasise, you know, the value of that team sport and, you know, the camaraderie that there was, even though many of them couldn't take part in activities in that first lockdown.
Thank you. Carol?
Yeah, thank you. Morning. I really want to touch on something that you spoke about, Mary, about the fact in more deprived areas it's so much more difficult for people. I think we need to be very honest with ourselves about what happens in those communities. So less and less funding is going to local government, and that is where people in those communities would be able to access more affordable and more local ability to take part in activity rather than just sport. So I'm wondering, you know, is it important for us to send a message to say that we have to resource local communities, particularly local communities in more deprived areas, if we are absolutely honest about getting people more active?
So I would absolutely agree that we need to increase the investment, and that's why we're doubling the investment in sport and physical activity in this term of Parliament, with a particular focus on inequalities. We want to reach those communities. We also want to reach the women and girls who we know are not participating in sport. We want to reach disabled people, and we want to see people from more black and minority ethnic communities participating in sport in Scotland. So we recognise that this is an area where inequalities it has an impact. We're doubling the investment, and we are looking to improve participation and to offer opportunities. Over the course of the pandemic, we saw active schools coordinators redeployed into schools to lead physical activity. We saw, for example, PE prioritised. So there are ways that we can, through that universal offer, make sure that children and young people still have an opportunity to participate. We also, as we came out of the pandemic, I mean, last year we had this investment over the course of the summer in a summer of fun or summer of activities, where we saw the active school coordinators make a real effort to support children and young people to be active, and again that was targeted in those more deprived communities. I think there are discussions to be had, and let me tell you, I have them on a regular basis, about whether there is support for example, the estate in all communities in Scotland. So in some local authority areas there are arm's length trusts. In some local authority areas there is a challenge with hanging on to the sporting estate. In some communities that's been quite welcomed, and we've seen sport clubs step up and take, you know, community empowerment in action, take over the running of those facilities and improve how they meet the needs of the community. But in some communities it's more challenging. But we are looking at that very closely. I don't think there'll be a one-size-fits-all. And we're looking at it very closely to ensure that whatever is done in each community, it meets the needs of the community that's there and people aren't left behind. The other thing I need to work on, and it is difficult because of the pandemic, because we're not out the other side yet, we're still in, you know, we still have COVID in this country, and we still have, you know, despite the fact we tipped under 6,000 cases yesterday, we still have it at reasonable levels in Scotland. We do need to ensure that children can access the school estate, and we need to work towards that. There are good pilot programmes going on. I think last time I was here at the committee, I talked about some of the work that's going on in Dundee to ensure that children can access the school estate for both sporting activities and for cultural activities, both of those with good evidence bases to support protection and mitigation against adverse childhood experiences. So we need to work with our local authority colleagues to ensure that we are all absolutely focused in the same direction and improving the situation for our children and young people.
This particular topic is exercising a lot of our... I won't be able to take this many supplementaries for every theme, but I think that we probably need to do our own session on sport directly, such as the amount of evidence we've heard and the amount of questions we've got. Can I bring Kevin Stewart on this before I go to Stephanie?
Just very briefly, convener, because local authorities also have the ability to use the Children's and Young People Community Mental Health Services money for sporting activities as well, in terms of children's wellbeing. And Ms Mohan will be very well aware, I'm sure, of the various projects that are going on in East Ayrshire. But one of the investments that East Ayrshire has made is in their Vibrant Communities project, which includes multidisciplinary community support, which includes sports coaches, for example. And there is flexibility in that resource. And of course, while we've invested £50 million over this year, next year, our ambition is part of the Bute House Agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Greens, is to double that investment over the course of this Parliament. So the flexibility is there for local authorities to use that money as well for mental wellbeing, because we know that sport has a vital role to play.
Thank you, Minister. Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. Good to see you both here this morning. My question goes back a wee bit there. We mentioned ACEs earlier on this morning there, and sadly that's something that's often passed down from generation to generation, that trauma repeats itself. And the Minister mentioned as well the excellent work that's been happening around perinatal mental health. And my question is really around building in that there. You know, we all know the happy mum, happy baby, but it goes beyond that. Happy mums, happy parents, happy children. The parental emotional health reflects huge amounts on how children feel growing up there as well. And I was speaking to the Chief Executive of North Lanarkshire Council yesterday, Des Murray, and he was talking about, you know, having young mums dropping their children off at nursery, for example, actually reaching out to that young mum at that point in time rather than them going home and being isolated, getting them engaged in services alongside. So whether it's having a coffee, whether it's accessing advice services, whether it's doing a bit of physical activity or whatever. So my question really is, what are we actually doing to promote this type of good practice here that really recognises how important parental wellbeing is in allowing our young children to flourish? Thanks.
Thank you.
So I think you're absolutely right. When children are being dropped off at nursery, it is a real opportunity to do something with the parents. And we've seen, again, you may want to ask Claire Hawkey more about this next week when she's here giving evidence, but we've certainly seen programmes being offered, that, like, for example, the PEEP programme, which encourages education and learning and qualifications, and that fulfilment of potential for the parent has a benefit for the child. I think over the course of the pandemic, there's no doubt that people have felt even more, parents have felt even more socially isolated than ever before. We've seen some innovative work to try to improve that. So outdoor walking groups where parents get together, using online social media groups to connect and get out together. I mean, I have to say, as a public health minister, there are very few positives I feel to come out of this pandemic. But if we become a nation that socialise through exercise, that will be a real positive to have come from the pandemic. I think there are opportunities to facilitate that. So as you say, these things aren't always, I mean, I'm a mum of three. It isn't always easy to walk up to a stranger at the school gate and say, do you want to go for a walk? So that element of facilitation that can be offered by the venues like the school nursery, like the health visitor who used to run, you know, a real life for mum and baby groups, these can definitely provide a huge opportunity to offer to give peer support to parents. And it's not just mums, there's, you know, dads too, to give peer support to parents and to encourage that peer relationship that is just so absolutely vital to good mental health.
I'm going to bring in Sandesh. Sandesh, you wanted to pick up on something around the eating disorders that Emma, and then we must move on to health inequalities. Time is running away from us. I knew it would. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I just wanted to pick up on something on the eating disorders that Emma Harper talked about. And eating disorders in adolescents have the highest rate of death, 23 times more rate of suicide than the general population. You said that, Minister, you said that referrals rocketed, and that is indeed true. And the Royal College of Psychiatry Vice Chair for CAM said they were struggling pre-pandemic. There's a lack of beds, Minister, and people are having to go to England, they're having to go privately. How can you increase the number of beds to prevent those at the top end from going down this horrible route?
Convener, I don't want anyone to have to go elsewhere for treatment. I want folk to remain as near their home as possible. Because one of the key things in all of this is the family support. And, you know, we have some very good practice in terms of supporting families where there is a distance to travel. But we probably have to do more on that front. I think the key thing for me, and I'm sure it's the same for Dr. Gohani as well, is to try and get to a situation where folk don't have to go into acute services. And that is why, you know, an amount of our investment has gone to the likes of BEAT. And, you know, what we need to build on is the community support that is available. You know, having visited the unit here in Edinburgh, for example, a huge amount of their work is around, is in the community rather than on the ward. I think we are in a situation at this moment where we are going to have to keep a very close eye on beds, and it may well mean more investment and an increase in the amount of beds. But I think it's preferable, and I'm sure Dr. Gohani would agree, that if we can keep folk out of hospital and provide them with the right support in the community, that would be the best way forward.
Can I come to Carol on health inequalities? Carol.
Oh, that's, sorry about that. Sorry, I've lost my pace. Thank you. I'm interested, obviously, in just how we address some of the inequalities that we see. We've talked a wee bit in terms of sport, but also across the board in terms of access to services. And I just wondered if either of the ministers had a view on how we could improve that.
So we have spoken, you and I have spoken many times in the chamber and at committee about the just... injustice of health inequalities. They're unjust and they're avoidable. And it's that difference in health between and within population groups that represent thousands of premature deaths. So it is absolutely high on my list of priorities to tackle them. We've spoken a little bit this morning already about what a long-term project that is, because many of the, you know, much of your life, it's not completely determined, but you know, your early years have a huge impact. And it's a clear ambition for Scotland to tackle health inequalities. All governments should want to tackle inequalities. In terms of your specifics of your question, in terms of accessing services, I mean, one of the things about certain populations are considered, and we often hear them talked about as being hard to reach. And I think, time and time again, I hear that being corrected and talked in policy circles about being easy to ignore. And there's a recognition that certain groups don't have a voice and aren't, you know, our services are not targeted towards them. We've seen, for example, I mean, if I take you a most recent example, the vaccine programme. So we had an imperative because of Omicron to get a booster vaccine into the arms of as many people in Scotland as we possibly could to protect ourselves from that pandemic and protect ourselves from the harm that was coming with that variant. And we targeted 80% before the bells, boosted by the bells. And we did really well with that. But what has proved harder is to reach the other 20%. And we have now, for example, specific programmes outreaching to drug and alcohol policy colleagues, colleagues outreaching to people who work with those who sell sex for a living, outreaching to specific communities like gypsy traveller communities. So it is slower and tougher work to get out and to reach those communities who are not well served by health services. But we recognise their need and we are doing work. And I think the vaccine programme shows you the level of work that is going on to make sure that they can access services. I mean, I could quote right across, you know, across the screening programme, for example, there's a health inequality. Uptake is lower in more deprived communities than in wealthier communities for screening right across the board. And there is work going on in every screening programme to try and tackle that. If we look specifically at cervical cancer screening, there is work, and this work is four-nation work, so it's not just in Scotland that we're troubled by this and wanting to improve it. We're doing work on, for example, self-sampling. We think that there are reasons why, either through embarrassment, through past sexual trauma, through just caring responsibilities, through disability, there are many reasons why women don't go for a cervical smear. And we're looking and studying on a UK-wide basis the possibility of home sampling to try to improve that and to try to ensure that there's a better take-up in those particular communities who don't take up those health offerings, those standard health offerings that we have. I don't think it'll solve the problem completely. I think these are, we say it time and time again, these are complex issues. But we will keep working at improving that, because if you look at, for example, the cervical screening programme, the impact is so huge. There's a possibility we can eradicate cervical cancer by, you know, the World Health Organization say it's doable to eradicate cervical cancer. If we can increase uptake of screening, if we can make sure that there's a good uptake of vaccination, there's a disease we can be rid of. So the prize is huge, but it's not easy, and we need to keep working at it and innovating and listening to the communities.
Thank you. One of the other things that some of the professionals talked to us about in evidence, and we hear time and time again, is that move towards prevention and how we try and improve that area of our work for people, particularly in more deprived communities. Do you think that we're doing enough in Scotland to move that to that model of prevention of these kinds of health difficulties that are causing such inequality?
So I think, if I'm honest, I think we're doing a lot. We're increasing the amount of money that people have in their pockets, which I think is a vitally important way to tackle health inequalities. Health inequalities are about wealth inequalities. So things like the Scottish Child Payment will make a difference. We are tackling, but I go back to the challenge of tackling some of these issues with one hand tied behind your back, or taking one step forward in Scotland and the UK government forces us to take a step back. And the frustration that causes me as somebody who is, like you, absolutely passionate and determined to improve that is a difficult one to bear, frankly. So, you know, we are doing a great deal of work in Scotland, but that £20 child payment will be negated by the decrease of £20 in universal credit. We are, you know, we're doing lots of work to support insulation of homes and you know, tackle fuel poverty. But the responsibility for fuel pricing and for VAT, which would make a real difference on fuel poverty, lies with Westminster. And so far, are pleased to tackle that issue. And I represent a part of the country where fuel poverty levels are really high, some of the highest in Scotland. Our appeals to tackle that is falling on deaf ears. So children in my part of the country, a huge percentage of them, 40 to 50% in some communities, are living in cold houses where their parents are having to choose between heating their home and feeding them. And those are the real challenges that we're facing. We must make progress, and we have to do everything we can, but we cannot pretend that we have every power to tackle these issues in Scotland. I mean, look at £600 million a year we spend mitigating Westminster policies. The bedroom tax would still be affecting disabled people in Scotland were we not spending the money mitigating that.
And I've got a couple of people want to come in. And yes.
Can I just say one thing here? Because I've said this regularly, and it's not just me. You know, a lot of the mental health professionals out there will say the same thing. Poverty is the main driver of mental ill health. And it is very difficult for some folks to engage in various programmes if they have got real concerns about how they're going to pay their bills, whether they're going to be able to feed their kids, whether they're going to be able to buy that pair of shoes for wee Johnny or Jenny going to school. And we can't get over the fact that much
of the powers here still rest with the UK government. And, you know, as Marie has said, we have a situation where we are doing our level best to mitigate some of the policy decisions from down south. But as we increase the Scottish child payment, which is the right thing to do, they take away all of that in terms of a universal credit cut. While, you know, we have mitigated the likes of the bedroom tax, they still have the welfare cap. And I think we have got to recognise that while we will do everything that we possibly can in these regards, it would be much more helpful if these welfare policies that have been enacted by the UK government were got rid of, because they have a major impact on the physical and mental well-being of so many folks in our country.
Thank you. Can I bring in Emma Harper, and I'll come to Sue? We've got quite a lot of people want to come in. Emma?
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick sup. The Minister, Marie Todd, you mentioned the progress on self-sampling for cervical cancer, and that's something that I've been interested in because NHS Dumfries and Galloway Health Board are part of the research. And my understanding is that there were 6,000 women who had defaulted from their smear, but 25% have now taken up the self-sampling. So that's 1,500 women who have been screened now who would not have attended in the past. So that looks like that might be an interesting progress in showing that self-sampling might be a way forward.
Absolutely, and it just shows you that these innovations, so reaching communities who are not participating in health programmes, particularly preventative health programmes, is a complex thing, and we need to be innovating right across the board and right across the lifespan to do that. But I'm delighted, I mean, your part of the country is contributing to the evidence base, which is building UK-wide. We can't move to self-sampling without being sure that it's safe and effective. Scotland is contributing to building that evidence, and I'm proud of that.
Mm-hmm. OK, can I bring in Sue Webber?
Thanks, Convener. Yes, given that the attainment gap has been widening quite significantly in the 15 years the SNP have been in power, so that's long before the pandemic, has your government identified where its previous approaches were failing, and have you devised new interventions so that the real progress can now be made as we exit the pandemic?
So I think that question is probably best put to the two ministers who are in front of you next year, but I have to challenge the brass neck, frankly, when we've just spent quite so long talking about the impact of the last 10, 11 years of austerity, the impact of welfare reform. You call it the attainment gap. The full name is the poverty-related attainment gap. You cannot close the poverty-related attainment gap without tackling poverty. And we've detailed very carefully just how many areas the party that you represent and the party that you support are undoing the work of the Scottish Government. Now, I'm not saying that we are powerless. We are not powerless in this situation. The investment in 1140 hours, for example, is one of the many ways that this government has committed and delivered for children and young people in this country. But to lay the increase in the poverty-related attainment gap at the SNP government's door, when the Westminster government has increased the level of poverty in this country, I think that's a difficult one to take. We can see the evidence. So Scotland, of the four UK countries, has the lowest level of poverty. The policies that we are enacting are making a difference. We have more affordable housing. That is one of the ways that we are making a difference to children and families in this country. There's actually an increase in food bank usage in all of the other countries in the UK. In Scotland, that is decreasing. Our policies are having an impact, but we are attempting to solve this problem without switching off the tap of appalling and damaging policies
coming from Westminster.
We're going to have to move on to one of our other themes on indicators and monitoring improvement. Questions led by Sandesh.
Thank you, Mina. I've got questions around data and our children's health. I know in your opening statement, Minister Todd, that you made reference to obesity and how you said Scotland has the best qualitative data that we're finding. But Dr. Booth, who told us in committee of the issue of inconclusive data on many health issues, diet, fitness and obesity were the ones that stood out as lacking in the Active Health Kids report card. So what data and how will you get it to look at diet, fitness, obesity?
So the first thing to say is, I mean, again, you weren't here when I made my opening statement. I understand that you were listening on your way in. But what I said early on in my... What I said early on in my evidence was that Scotland had some of the best quality improvement methodology in the NHS in Scotland. I don't think I said we had some of the best data. And certainly the data collection has been impaired by the last 2 years of pandemic. So we haven't been able to ask frontline staff to collect data with quite the same rigour and effort over the last 2 years while they've been on an emergency footing as we would be in normal times. So in terms of the data on obesity, we do have certain points at which we measure children's weight. For example, I talked about the data that came out at the tail end of last year, which has given us a really worrying concern. So we found in December 2021, the children coming into primary one, 15.5% of children were at risk of obesity, 5.1% increase on pre-pandemic levels. That has got, you know, you don't need to be a data analyst to be concerned about that increase. So we do have data, and I think we have enough data to recognise that there's a problem. What we need now is to enact policies that make a difference and make a difference quickly.
Sandesh?
Well, I mean, Dr. Booth would disagree with what you've just said there, Minister, and I think we need to be clear that without good data, without data that we're able to use and also look at how your policies are enacted and what differences they make, then we're not really going to go really further forward, are we, Minister?
We have child surveillance data. That programme has continued during the course of the pandemic. We have local reporting on child healthy weight pathway standards. We have collect data that shows us the inequality gap. So we can see quite clearly that obesity is more of a problem in more deprived areas. It's a poverty issue, again, related to the level of poverty in the community rather than in the family and in the community rather than as much as anything else. So we do have, I would say, some good data that tells us where it is we need to target our interventions. We can always get more data and we can always have better data. And, you know, you and I are both clinicians. I'm a big fan of evidence-based practice. And in order to have high-quality evidence-based practice, you do need to have good data. But I would say on the childhood obesity issue, we have sufficient data to tell us there is a problem and to indicate where we need to turn our attention.
Finally, Minister, then, if we have all the data that you think we need, why are we not seeing an improvement?
So I would say, again, what we see is a strong inequality gradient. So this is a poverty-related issue. We are tackling poverty with at least one hand tied behind our back. If I could reiterate again that each lever that we pull to improve child poverty, for example, the Scottish Child Payment, £20, the Westminster government, which your party is in government in Westminster, you're a GP, you ought to understand the social determinants of health. You work in Glasgow, that should give you a very good understanding of the social determinants of health. If you have one government giving with one hand and another government taking away with the other, you will struggle to see improvement. Add to that, we have had 2 years of a pandemic where we have detailed clearly
what the impact on physical activity was for children and young people, reduced level of active travel, not attending school, people living in poverty, unable to access the outdoors and exercise, you can see that things would undoubtedly get worse. We do have, as well, an obesogenic environment, and we are going to have to acknowledge that and understand and work on that. And actually, we have some good work going on a four-nation basis with the UK government to tackle the obesogenic environment. They're doing some, bringing in some policies around advertising of foods that are high in fat and salt and sugar before the watershed. I'm really pleased about that. We've been asking about that for a long time. We'll work together where our policy is aligned, but we need to tackle the food environment, as well as the opportunities for physical activity, as well as fundamentally, we will not solve this problem without tackling poverty.
Move on to questions on impact assessments from Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I don't require long responses to these questions. Can I ask how the government ensures that services for children and young people are designed in a way that reflects diversity?
So what I would say is I think that all of us, the pandemic has shone a light on inequality. I'll try not to talk for a long time. I'll take your guidance, Ms. Bailey. The pandemic has shone a light on inequalities, and it's shone a light on pre-existing inequalities. And I would say the area of that issue of systemic inequalities for black and minority ethnic communities has really had a light shone on it globally throughout the world. It's almost as if the scales fell from our eyes and we realised that what we were doing was perpetuating inequalities in some cases rather than tackling them. We have in the Scottish Government a strong history of working with communities, ensuring that the voice of lived experience is at the heart of the development of policies with children and young people. I mean, again, you may wish to ask Claire Hawkey this. We did a lot of work to ensure that children's voices were right at the centre of the development of policies. So I think it is somewhere where we are making some efforts. I wouldn't go so far as to say we are having the impact yet that we desire.
Okay.
Kevin Stewart, want to come in?
Yeah. Because I think we are making moves to improve. So if we look at psychological therapies and CAMHS, for example, the new national data set for these specialisms will provide individual level data for the first time, including experience and outcome measures, which I think is a major, major move forward.
Thank you for that. In 2018, you published the Progressing Human Rights of Children in Scotland Action Plan. Part of that was to have wellbeing impact assessments for children. So can I ask you, have the child rights and wellbeing impact assessments been applied to all new legislation and policy that impacts on children? Has that been applied?
So certainly that is a routine. As new policy is developed and new legislation comes in, that would be a standard part of the practice, yeah.
Okay, that's good to
hear. Can I add to that? Hold on
one second. I'll direct my next question to you and you can wrap them both up together. So has the full child rights and wellbeing impact assessment of the mental health and recovery plan been published?
Convener, in terms of CRWIA, we carried out a screening in February 2021. We adopted as a government a consistent approach to rights and equality, which has been used across all of the protected categories when assessing the deliverables in the mental health transition and recovery plan. Our Mental Health Equalities and Human Rights Forum is central to this. Crucially, we continue to involve children and young people
in all aspects of our mental health and wellbeing focused actions. As we have, Ms Todd and I have reiterated again and again today, lived experience should be at the heart of all that we do. And for example, the involvement of members of the Scottish Youth Parliament enriches the work of our Scottish Government COSLA, Joint Delivery Group for Children and Young People's Mental Health. And we have two participation officers attached to that who focus on children's and young people's engagement.
That's a really helpful response and very interesting information, but I asked a very specific question. You published the screening information 1 year ago. Has the full CRWIA now been published?
As Ms Bailey well knows, we have gone through a global pandemic. We are getting back to some kind of normality. I've outlined what we have done around about CRWIAs. We know that we have more to do on this front, and we will do it.
OK, and that's helpful to know, but I take it from that answer, you haven't published it yet. Do you have a date for when it will be published?
We will write to the committee around about a publication date, convener. But what I would say to all members is we have an ambition here, and we will meet that ambition. And I think folk have got to recognise that we have had 2 years of a global pandemic, which means that some of the work that we want to undertake has been put to one side in order to deal with the real crises that we have faced and that people have faced because of coronavirus.
Okay, I want to give the rest of the session over. They've got two themes coming up that I know that a lot of people want to ask questions on. I'll come back to you in a second, but I'm just saying we've got two themes coming up, family-centred services and mental health. I really do want to get to them because we've got a lot of people want to ask questions. Jackie, final question, yes, and I'll need to move on.
And I think it's important because I was asking about an impact assessment about a mental health and recovery plan at which we would all acknowledge children should be at the heart of it. So if you're going to write to the committee, that's great, but do you publish centrally a list of all the children's rights and wellbeing impact assessments across government?
We will write to the committee around about that too, convener.
We need to pick up with Claire Hawkey next week, because obviously a lot of that is probably best put to the minister.
There is, I recall from my time as Minister of Children and
Young
People.
We'll ask Claire Hawkey about that last week. And that's why we're having so many ministers and a cabinet secretary in front of us, because this does cut across the whole of government. Can I come to our theme on family-centred services and family support, and Evelyn Tweed?
Thanks, convener. Is enough investment in place to enable holistic family support to be available throughout Scotland? So it's a good question. I mean, it is challenging. So one of the challenges related to that question is that holistic family support is definitely going to look different in different parts of the country. There isn't a one-size-fits-all. There is a different way of delivering services to support families in an urban area versus a more rural area. But holistic whole family support is absolutely central to our aim in Scotland. It is central to keeping the promise. So if you think about, and it kind of builds on work that's been done for years. If you think about getting it right for every child, that is very much about, you know, pulling all of the people who need to be involved around the child and collaboration and prevention. Holistic family support will build on that. The reason, you know, the independent care review shone a light on some really difficult, we heard some really difficult stories and it is impossible to ignore them. And we in government and the parliament have made a promise to our children and young people who are care experienced that we will do more to support their families to prevent children ever requiring the care of the state and needing to come into care. So there is, we have a lot of investment there. We have a long way to go, though, I think, before we get to that genuine, holistic, preventative family support. For too many families in Scotland, they reach crisis before support is there. And I've talked a lot this morning about universal services that are available to support families. We need to get better at identifying those families who are really struggling and need more support and putting extra support in before the family is in real trouble. Children live in families and families are vital.
Evelyn?
Maybe adds to that, because I think the holistic whole family support and whole family wellbeing fund are absolutely vital in getting this right as we move forward. And again, you know, you will hear from our other colleagues as well that what we are doing here in terms of this work, as well as being multidisciplinary and multi-agency, we are cross-cutting in government in order to get this absolutely right for families across the country. And we have real ambition here in terms of this. The work is, largely being led by other ministerial colleagues, but we are all involved in the overview in this in the group that is chaired by the Deputy First Minister. This is important. In order for us to move beyond just getting it right for every child and getting it right for everyone, this is one of the main policy planks that will help us do that.
Evelyn?
Thanks, convener. And in a similar vein, just to expand on what you've said, what steps is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that services are organised around a family or the individual rather than being set up to address single issues?
Well, again, this is work that we're doing at this moment in time, and you know, a huge amount of my time since I got this role last May has been talking to stakeholders. And I talked earlier about the example of that young man with all of those interventions, those 15. And I think, you know, sometimes again we have situations where families have a huge amount of interventions, but there's not that holistic approach. And I think National Care Service and new standards can make a real difference there. However, we need to change cultures as well around about how we support families. Because we know that, you know, where there are too many interventions, as I mentioned earlier, sometimes the trust factor is not there. And you don't get the positive results. No one gets the positive results that they want because that trust is not there. So, as well as that multidisciplinary approach that I talked about, as well as that multi-agency report approach, what we actually need to do is to ensure that in order to get this right, that we have folk in play that families can trust. That will make a real difference, I think. And that's why, you know, I and other colleagues are quite excited around about the way that we can approach this, improve and modernise for families right across the country.
Can I just chip in very quickly? So there's a transformational shift, or we're aiming for a transformational shift in how this works. There's a work going on right across government. And the Deputy First Minister's role in COVID recovery and that cross-cutting, cross-portfolio role and children and families being prioritised in the recovery kind of illustrates the way that we're trying to do it at a government level. There's a substantial investment, so £500 million, which is, you know, a substantial investment given the challenges that we're facing economically at the moment. Behind that aim to shift and transform the way that we work, there's the work of the promise, which is also driving and holding us to account on that work. And if you think as well about, you know, the incorporation of UNCRC, one of the things that we hoped for from that piece of legislation, and we're still committed to the policy outcomes, even though the legislation has been contested by the Westminster government. What we were hoping for from that piece of legislation was a shift in culture, so that instead of looking at a child in front of you and gatekeeping the various funding, you know, thinking, you know, do they need this, do they need that, you looked at the child and thought, what are those child's rights and how can I support and respect those rights? And if those rights crucially, if those rights were not supported and respected, it was justiciable. So you could be taken to court for not respecting those rights. That would have changed the culture.
And I think, Convener, as well, we fully intend to keep the promise and we intend to ensure that we deal with the difficulties that were highlighted in the independent report in adult social care. And in order for us to be able to do that, we need to shift the financial alignment and the balance of investment that we make in this area so that we're not spending constantly on crisis intervention, as is often the case, but actually on prevention. And that will free up even more resource to do that. And of course, by doing it that way, we also lessen the human cost of not getting this right.
Thank you. Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan? You have some questions on this theme.
Thank you, Convener. A couple of questions. I'll just ask them both at once and you might want to answer them together. I'm wondering how important a place-based approach is, you know, having facilities that are side by side there that can help facilitate families accessing services. And again, going back to North Lanarkshire, I know what they're doing is they've got a single multidisciplinary team approach where they actually have shared budgets and shared decision-making. And I'm wondering if that's something the Scottish Government is looking at and any comments that you might have on it. Thank you.
Add it from a mental health perspective first and then I'll come to...
Well, you might get it from a mental health perspective and maybe a wee back into history and a planning perspective as well, Convener, because I think that this is a really important question that Ms Callaghan has asked. It's one of the reasons why 20-minute neighbourhoods featured in the SNP manifesto and I think in the manifestos of the Scottish Greens as well, if I remember rightly, but Ms Mackay will maybe correct me there. It is really, really important that as we plan our neighbourhoods, that we get it right. In terms of our net zero ambitions and our ambitions for vibrant communities, that is the right way forward. I know that in some local authorities, there is much more advancement in terms of this kind of work. There should be more of it, as far as I'm concerned. I know from my own experience in local government as well that the likes of planning for real exercises involving communities and individuals is a good way of getting this balance right. You know, not everybody gets what they want. That's a reality. But if you set down the parameters, that is really helpful in terms of shaping the future of communities. So this is important. I think we have got the right planning regime in place now to allow that to go forward, including the opportunity for neighbourhoods and communities to be involved in local place planning. But what we need to do in that regard, and I'm sorry for those folks that have been around a while, I relate back to a point which I made all of the time. We have to bring community planning and spatial planning together and not see them as separate in order to be able to do that. And if we do that, if we achieve that, we know that that can be very good for folks' physical health, but also for their mental well-being as well. So I think, you know, there's a lot of work to be done here. Many areas are embarking on it. Some are further on in that journey. But, you know, this is good stuff as far as I'm concerned and, you know, is the right thing to do as we move forward.
Briefly, if Stephanie's
can
all right.
I just, mention as well,
I just want to put the word rural in there as well.
Sure.
And I think before Emma Harper comes in, because I can see rural representative, I'm rural based and I'm always very aware of when this 20-minute neighbourhood is mentioned. And obviously, it's not going to be 20 minutes in rural areas, but it's almost like the ethos is around it being nearby. Can you factor that into your answer?
Yeah, because I think for many folks who have thought about this for a long while, if you are in a rural area, particularly in a remote rural area, an island community, not everything is necessarily going to be on your doorstep. That's right. But there are other ways of delivering services within those communities. So let's take, for example, rural Aberdeenshire. Let's go with your constituency, convener, because there are many remote rural places within your constituency. I know that some folk would find that hard to believe, but it is the case. And I think there are ways of delivering services there, which are different, which make sure that those communities can still flourish and benefit from those services. So during the course of the pandemic period, we've seen a rise in the use of telemedicine, but telemedicine in Grampian, which was the trailblazer, was ongoing long before the pandemic period. So we can deliver a lot of services to remote rural communities online. And we have to think around about what is required. So look at mental health services, for example. And I have to say that in some regards, I was sceptical around about some of the online provision. But it works for people. It works well. And again, you know, in your neck of the woods, convener, in Grampian, over the course of the pandemic period, the Grampian Resilience Hub did extremely well in bringing services to folk into folks' own houses at a point where they couldn't get out or couldn't move from Newmacher into services in Aberdeen or Inch into Aberdeen or wherever it may be. So, you know, there are ways of doing this, and it isn't just about the physical aspect of that 20 minutes. It's also what can we do in terms of the online world to bring those services to communities that are more remote, rural and island. Okay. And sorry if I've gone on too long there.
No, that's fine. That's fine. And I'll bring Stephanie back in after Marie Todd has mentioned, and then we'll move on to talking about mental health more generally.
Just two very quick points. One, NHS near me, I'm pretty sure it was developed in NHS Highland by pharmacists. But deeply involved in it, so I'm not gonna let Grampian claim NHS near me, but NHS near me is a really fascinating development over the course of the pandemic. It was something that was developed in Highland because of the challenges of accessing services in distant hospitals largely, and actually what we found is even with the need and the imperative of huge distances involved, it didn't happen wholesale until the pandemic tipped the balance and made people try it. So despite the advantages of NHS near me, it wasn't widely used until the pandemic. And I think what we've seen is it during the course of the pandemic with NHS near me is some really interesting data around empowerment of people, which is really important for their health. So people are not walking into buildings and becoming patients as they walk through the door. They're in their own homes. They're empowered to look after themselves. There's some interesting, subtle stuff happening around the edges of that. The other thing I just wanted to mention, just in terms of your place-based community services, all really important. Couldn't agree more with what my colleague Kevin Stewart has said. But just yesterday, we made an announcement as a government and implemented a policy on accessing free bus transport for all children under 22. And that is an evidence-based intervention which will, you know, very early on I spotted there was some growing up in Scotland data that showed that access to transport could mitigate and prevent adverse childhood experiences for folk in the with the highest rates of poverty. So that is really, you know, a thinking out of the box way of making a difference to these challenges, and it just shows you how important it is to have all of government focused on tackling these things.
Quick follow-up, Stephanie, then we must move on to mental health.
Convener, I think you'll be really glad to know that I don't have any further questions, but I should have mentioned that I'm a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council. That's all I was looking to get.
Okay, that's fine. Talking about mental health more generally, and I know that there will be supplementary questions coming, and we're going to use the rest of the session to talk about mental health, but led by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ministers. It was recently reported since 2014 that Scots have been abused due to their sexual orientation more than 7,500 times, while the number of hate crimes relating to transgender identity doubled between 2014 and 2020. We know that 40% of LGBT young people consider themselves to have a mental health problem, compared with 25% of all young people in Scotland. Are mental health and other support services equipped to deal with the particular issues and trauma faced by LGBT young people?
I think in many places they are. I think we do very well in those places where services listen to young folks, folk with lived experience, where there is that communication, collaboration and cooperation. That doesn't work so well for others, I have to say. And this is one of the reasons why, we have put in place the CAMHS service standards that we have. There is work to do there, without a doubt. We need to have young folk at the very heart of shaping these services in the future. I'll be honest with the committee, having talked to a lot of young folk over the past number of months, some of the issues that have been raised with me are ones which, I would not necessarily have thought of. And I think that we need to make sure that we are capturing all of the difficulties that young folk face. So let me give some examples there, because we have the school counselling service, which is an important move forward in terms of mental health service delivery. We're beginning to get the data from that counselling services around about what the main challenges that young people are coming to those counsellors about. And LGBT plus issues are up there. So we have to take cognizance of that and ensure that we're shaping the right services for the future to do right by folks.
And on the school counsellors, I've spoken to several stakeholders, school counsellors, phenomenal thing to have. But I've spoken to several stakeholders who believe we need training places for mental health clinicians to be more accessible from a diversity of backgrounds. For example, as you'll know, training to be a mental health counsellor takes a significant financial investment in terms of supervision and often a large amount of voluntary work to make up accreditation hours. And for many who we would maybe like to see in a counselling position, people who wear care experiences as children and young people, or people from lower social economic backgrounds, these barriers can often be exclusionary from entering this type of profession. So what can government do to ensure that we can have more of these people in place? Because for children and young people who have these experiences, having a counsellor who understands that the lifestyle they're coming from or the background they're coming from is imperative for some of these young people to build trust.
I agree with the points that Ms. Mackay has made, convener. And I think, we have got a job of work to do in ensuring that we've got the right mental health workforce for the future. And that includes looking at the entry into the profession. And it also includes getting the educational elements of this right and allowing folks the pathways, the career pathways that they may wish. So we've got some work to do there, but if we are absolutely, truly serious about getting mental health services right and fit for the future, which I am, we need to recognise that we need more diverse folk in that profession. And again, we have to be flexible in terms of that workforce. So we've talked about school counselling. One of the next big moves, of course, is around about folks in the primary care setting, which is extremely important. And I've had conversations with a number of colleagues around about the table, about how we can get that right, because it cannot be the same old. We need folks from diverse backgrounds, but beyond that, we need these workers to be multidisciplinary in what they do. I'll be honest with you, I'm willing to also steal good ideas from elsewhere. I met with Dr. Gohani
a couple of weeks ago around about children's wellbeing practitioners and what they're doing south the border. I'm quite happy to nick good ideas if they fit into that. That's grand. But I think, you know, one of the main things that we need to do here is to make sure that that is a diverse workforce that caters for the needs of all of society, not just the LGBT plus community, but as Ms. Todd mentioned earlier, our minority ethnic communities that are often not brought into play enough in these regards, and in particular, folks will know that I've had a real interest in what more we need to do to support our Gypsy Traveller community, and you know, we've got to get this right for all.
That's good. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. I'd like to ask specifically about girls and what we're doing to, because one of the things that we have heard and we've seen in the statistics is that the increase in referrals for mental health services, particularly during the pandemic, has affected adolescent young women and girls. But also, I know we are talking about mental health. I would like to, after I've spoken to, heard from the mental health minister, the physical health of girls as well and the access to sport. And physical activity drops off at a certain point, and that has an impact on mental health as well. So can I come to Kevin Stewart first of all and see what we're doing specifically to assist girls' mental health?
Convener, the evidence has been clear since before the pandemic that girls and young women appear to experience poorer mental health and well-being than boys. And we undertook research on the reported worsening of mental well-being of young women and girls, which was published in 2019. This research highlighted several interrelated drivers that may have contributed to these trends, which included things like body image concerns, for example. And to further explore some of the causes of this trend, we established the Scottish Government National Advisory Group on Healthy Body Image for Children and Young People, which published their recommendations in March of 2020. And we're currently working on meeting those recommendations. So that is one area where, you know, we need to move further forward. Again, I know that there's been discussion at the committee and evidence given around about screen time and the impact that can have on young folk, that social media use. And it's not just the body image aspect, although that's way up there. And again, you know, we're looking to resource work there and to work with Young Scots to bring forward a national conversation on body image, screen time and mental well-being. We want to hear directly the voices of young folk around about this in order that we shape our future work absolutely right. Again, we've touched upon eating disorders today, and young girls are disproportionately impacted by eating disorders and exacerbated during the course of the pandemic period. And I've already outlined some of the work that we are undertaking there. The other thing which we very much need to do is to better understand the mental health needs of women and girls affected by gender-based violence. Having recently funded and published an improvement service report on this important subject, we are now considering how best to take forward its recommendations, and we'll link all of that work to a refresh of the Scottish Government's Equally Safe Delivery Plan. And there's one other thing which I would like to touch upon, where, again, we need to do more, and that is autism in young women. Because I've heard, and I'm looking at faces because I think others have probably heard the same thing, that it is much, much more difficult for a young girl, a young woman, to be diagnosed as autistic. And often they're left in limbo for a long while, and diagnosis comes far too late. And we have got to ensure that we work on this, and it's going to take a fair amount of graft, I have to say, in order to get that right for the future. So I hope that gives you a flavour, convener, of some of the work which I see as being priority. But, you know, there are many other things that we're doing also.
Thank you. And I'm glad you mentioned the gender-based violence aspect of things, because I do think that the pressure that young women are under, a lot of misogyny and sexual harassment starts very early, and tackling that at school levels is really important from an early intervention point of view.
You know, we only have to look at news reports from yesterday and the impact that that can have on young women. So, you know, day and daily, this is a difficulty for young women. We've got to get this right as we move forward, and we're committed to doing that.
Can I bring in Maritov from that other aspect, what I asked about, you know, the physical health and the impact of young women giving up physical activity at that almost that transitional point from primary to secondary school? I mean, from your perspective as Women's Minister and Public Health Minister.
You're absolutely right. So one of the reasons that women suffer health inequalities is that reduction in sport and physical activity. Before puberty, the levels of sport and physical activity for children is pretty similar for boys and girls. But after puberty, young women are less likely to participate and less likely to exercise. And that has an impact on their physical health and, of course, on their mental health. So we're determined to improve that. That doubling of investment in sport and active living to £100 million by the end of this term of Parliament is focused on tackling those inequalities. There's a real focus on, there's a couple of things we're doing. So, I mean, again, you can't think of this issue without thinking about, you know, the reality of the world, as we've just highlighted, is that that women and girls face sexual discrimination and gender-based violence from a very young age. Sport alone isn't going to overturn that, but it can be part of the solution in amongst a whole programme of government efforts to make that to tackle the environment which enables that. We're looking at things like sports sponsorship to try to ensure that women's sport is equally supported as men's. We're looking at, we're hoping to hold a summit with about media coverage of women's sport. You know, one of the challenges is the focus on men's sport, and you know, we all know you can't be what you can't see. So one of the reasons that young girls stop participating in sport is because they don't see it reflected in the world around them. So we've got some ideas on how to do that. Let me see, each time, I mean, I meet with a lot of stakeholders as well. So just in the last week, I've met with the SFA to discuss the power of football. Fiona McIntyre, who's the head of Women and Girls Football, was at that meeting. I mean, I have to say, myself and the Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Youssef, were quite blown away by the work that the SFA brought to us. Football's the most popular sport in Scotland, and if we can work together to tackle some of these inequalities, I think we'll be a powerful force.
Included in this discussion?
Yes, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Not that one with the football, but there, the media summit, absolutely. And there are some outstanding female journalists, but you know, this is where we see, and media and social media is where we see some of the most ingrained misogynistic attitudes expressed. The other group I spoke to just last week, who have some great ideas about how to increase female participation and a real opportunity to do so, was Nick Rennie and Sophie McCall, who are involved in the cycling world. And we've got the UCI World Championships coming here in 2023. We've got an increased interest in cycling during the pandemic. We've got the World Championships coming. We've got net zero imperatives to drive us towards active transport, and we've got a real opportunity to increase participation in cycling amongst women. 75% of women don't cycle. don't use a bike. We can, you know, we have a low-hanging fruit there. We can definitely improve that. And what we need to do, I mean, it's, again, none of these answers are straightforward.
I could improve that, but I'll leave that for now. Can I bring in Sue Weber?
We need
Weber?
To make it safer and easier.
Can I bring in Sue Weber on this?
Thank you very much, Convener. We've heard a lot of evidence today and a lot of commentary from both of you that's been great to hear it around the prevention and the early intervention agenda in terms of your approach to the health and well-being of children and young adults. We've heard a little bit there about how cycling is going to save the world. It's a shame that the bikes that they've got haven't yet materialised that were promised for our young people. But with real-life waiting times for CAMs being so wide of the mark, are we not in a position where the prevention and the early intervention agenda is going to take a back seat? And it's just fantasy at this stage because we have to tackle the crisis and the waiting lists that are facing us right now.
No, I think we have to ensure that community-based services are as good as they possibly can be in order to stop folk reaching acute services. That is the ambition here. And as we move forward, we want to invest more in that preventative approach. That's why we have invested in school counsellors. That is why we are investing in primary care. And that is why we're investing in community resources as well. Now, I would agree, Convener, that we have got work to do in terms of reducing CAMs waiting times and waiting lists. And, you know, we get fixated around about the statistics, but all of this is people and their families. And I recognise that this is a particularly stressful time for folks who are waiting. And I want to ensure that we have a service whereby we reduce those times and those lists. Now, there are lessons which, you know, have been learned pre-pandemic, which, you know, has led to the modernisation of services in certain places that we need to ensure happens everywhere. And that's why we've put the standard in place, to make sure that everybody follows that way. So I'll give Ms. Weber an example, and I think I may have given it before, so I apologies if I do. You know, if we look at CAMs waiting times and lists, you know, in Grampian, they have done fairly well even during the course of the pandemic. They previously were not in a good place if you go back a decade or so. They modernised the service, much more community focus, much more emphasis of helping folk and communities. That has made a real difference. We need to ensure that that best practice, those models, are exported across the country. That will reduce lists and reduce waiting times. What I am also keen to do, Convener, in all of this, and somebody mentioned data earlier, I have to say that in some regards, I get frustrated when we're comparing apples with oranges. We have to get the data right in all of this too, to ensure that we have everything at our fingertips for the knowledge to show what investment we require in the future. And finally, Convener, to show how seriously we take all of this, from the Renewal Fund, Recovery and Renewal Fund, we've invested £40 million of the £120 million in CAM services, because that's how important we feel this is a priority.
Final question on this from... Yes.
Apologies. Just a couple of things in response to Sue Weber's questions. Firstly, one of the services, the sort of unsung heroes in this whole picture are school nurses, and we are investing to increase the number of school nurses. An extra 250 school nurses will be recruited, which their role is very much around supporting school-aged children, and they play a vital role in improving their health and well-being. There's some evidence that, you know, investing in school nurses can reduce the requirement for CAMHS. So we are continuing to invest in the preventative work. If I could pick up on your issue around the bikes, we have a number of bike pilots going on around Scotland which are looking not just at getting bikes into the hands of children and young people, but also at the barriers that they might face to cycling. So have they got somewhere to store the bike? Have they got someone who, in their community, who can fix the bike? Have they got access to cycle routes? And we are also in those projects exploring ensuring access for disabled people. So another group in society who face health inequalities, who are unable to participate in sport. And we are determined to use the learning from those pilots. And clearly you're not aware of those pilots, so I'll make sure that in our letter following up to committee we give you some information about that, but that will improve things. The final thing I wanted to mention is Sport Scotland have a strategic partnership with SAMH, a leading mental health charity, just to consolidate the work across the board between sport and mental health to make sure that everything that we are doing is as impactful as it can possibly be. There's a couple of places they've started already. So they've done things like, over 1,300 staff members of the Scottish sport workforce, including active schools coordinators, have attended a total of 110 sessions, including maintaining wellbeing reflection session, how to have a mental health conversation, mental health awareness workshops. All of this work is important, and that is vitally important to the preventative work. Sport in its own is really good for your mental health, but we are trying to maximise the impact of sport by working smartly with partners and, you know, enhance the work that's going on. And I think we are see some benefits.
Thomas Emma Harper, a final question. So
convener,
yes,
because I think it's important to put on record our thanks to the staff who work in mental health services, but particularly in CAMHS. I should say to the committee, and we'll provide more detail as always, because I know that you're going to ask for it after this session anyway, but the last quarter saw a record number of new patients starting treatment in CAMHS. As our NHS continues to remobilise and, of course, demand has increased too. But, you know, that is a record number of new patients entering CAMHS, and that's down to the efforts of the workforce. An increased workforce, we know we've got more to do there, an increased workforce, but they have been absolutely amazing and rising to what is a challenge. And I hope that they... and know that they will continue to do that. And we'll send you more details of the numbers around about that, because I know the committee is always interested.
Very short question from Emma.
Thanks, convener. It's just a quick question about the importance of tackling stigma and discrimination. We've talked about that in the past. And obviously, if we reduce stigma, then more young men, young women, young persons will come forward. I know there's a campaign in Dumfries called Skate Out of Darkness that the ice hockey team are doing in order to tackle stigma and discrimination. So that's important work. So just maybe a couple of comments on that, on the importance of stigma.
The project that Ms Harper has talked about there is not one I'm aware of, so she may want to furnish me with further detail, and I'll have a look and see what work they're doing. I'm sure it's very good work. I've said to the committee previously that there is good work in destigmatising mental health going on in communities across Scotland. Nationally, we have provided £5 million over 5 years for CME to give them the comfort of knowing that that resource is available over a longer period of time. They have done some immense work, but we still have a way to go. And there are some areas of mental health which we have to destigmatise further. Areas like self-harm, for example, where it is much more difficult for folk to talk about it. And I've met with representatives from
the Labour Party and the Green Party about our ambition to create the world's first, I think, self-harm strategy. And we're going to have to get folk to open up in order to be able to do that right, and we're going to have to destigmatise. I'm due to meet with Conservative and Liberal Democrat representatives around about this too in the near future. And I hope that we can work on a cross-party basis collaboratively to help destigmatise that area, because there is a lot of work to do there. And hopefully we'll see collaboration and cooperation right across the Parliament on what is an issue that we have not done enough to tackle.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank both ministers for their time this morning. Marie Todd's going to be joining us in the next session. We are going to take a break until 11:15, but I'm going to suspend the session. Hey, welcome back to our meeting. Our third item today is an evidence session on two common frameworks, and these are the organs, tissues and cells, apart from embryos and gametes, provisional common framework, and the blood safety and quality provisional common framework. And we still have our Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport with us, Marie Todd. Thanks for staying on. And joining the Minister online, we have our official Sam Baker, Team Lead for Donation and Abortion Policy Team, and Sharon Grant, Donation and the Policy Team Member as well. So, Minister, I think whenever it comes to frameworks, I ask this general question. What does the framework mean for Scotland?
So, I have some introductory remarks, which I can use to set the
You're
context.
You're most welcome to deliver them.
Thank you. Firstly, thanks for inviting me along to the committee to consider these provisional common frameworks. Officials in my team have been working with our counterparts in the UK government, the Welsh government and Northern Ireland executive to develop a four-nation approach to the delivery of the EU repatriated functions on common areas of interest within these frameworks. And the ministers of the four nations have agreed the content of these provisional frameworks, which were published on the 2nd of December 2021. So policy on organs, tissues, cells and blood safety and quality were and continue to be highly regulated at an EU level. And the purpose of these frameworks, what do they give Scotland, to respond to your question, is to ensure that there's a joined up approach across the UK post-EU exit to the continued maintenance of high standards of safety through the delivery of regulatory functions in these areas. And that includes agreement as to how divergence will be managed within the UK, as well as setting out governance and decision-making processes. And throughout the process, we've committed to continuing to work collaboratively on developing common frameworks on the basis of consensus and in line with the agreed principles of the Joint Ministerial Committee for European Negotiations as of October 2017. The provisional frameworks have been operational on an interim basis since the end of the transition period, and they'll remain provisional until the parliamentary scrutiny by all legislatures has been completed. And I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you. That answers my very broad question. I'll come to Emma Harper, who's got some follow-up on that. Emma.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Just I'm interested in, like, as a former liver transplant nurse in Los Angeles, I was always interested in looking at the tracking, the tracing, the safety, where the organs come from. So to what extent is the cross-border sharing of tissues, organs, blood, how much is that an issue for us in Scotland?
So it's an area that we've always worked well and collaborated well on on a four nations basis. And it's vitally important that we do. We're quite a small country, and we sometimes require organs for individual citizens in Scotland which aren't available in Scotland, and vice versa. We sometimes have organs that we can't use in Scotland. So it's really important that we have ways of sharing this. It's not unusual to operate that type of system across a unit, for example, like the UK. And also sometimes these collaborations occur on an even wider basis. So, you know, I think there are a couple of instances where we've shared organs into the Republic of Ireland, and I think there are arrangements in place for that to happen with France as well. But it's really important that there are really high standards and that each nation is aware of the standards that are operating in each country in order to make sure that is safe and transparent.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Stephanie, sorry, did you want to come in on this particularly, Sue?
It's just out of curiosity, I suppose, and interest. You know, anyone that is a donor, I would want to make sure that every organ that they donate as possible upon their dying is used. So is there going to be anything that inhibits that from happening from this policy? No.
I can reassure people. So, you know, it's an incredible gift that people give when they donate their organs. And I can reassure them that we are grateful for them and we will use them all over the UK to help people who need them.
Thank you. Stephanie.
Thank you, convener.
So during the development of the framework, just looking to find out, you know, what sorts of discussions was it that took place? What were the key areas of debate? And are there any notable areas of disagreements?
So to reassure you, there aren't. There's a great deal of collaboration goes on in this particular policy area anyway, and there are good, strong reasons for us not to dispute, you know, and to work well together. And there are very few. I can't anticipate areas of divergence, but as with all these frameworks, it's really important to build in a possibility for that to happen. We do have, you know, we have different legislation and we have a different NHS. It might be necessary to do things slightly different in each of the four UK nations. And there is built into the framework a possibility of divergence. That doesn't mean it's inevitably going to happen, but the possibility is there. And it's really important that that's maintained and that there are mechanisms for resolving any areas of conflict and enabling divergence should that be needed.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay wanted to come in.
Thank you. Were any concerns about the frameworks raised by stakeholders? The committee didn't receive any responses to its calls for views, so it would be good to understand if any concerns were raised with the government.
So I'm not aware of any concerns being raised. I mean, not certainly not relating to these specific frameworks. I mean, there is, you know, there's a general concern about the way that these frameworks operate. In general, the powers that were repatriated to the EU and certainly the UK internal market bill causes all of the devolved governments real concern. It wasn't given consent in Scotland. It wasn't given consent in Wales. So there are some general discussions, but in these specific policy areas, no, I'm not aware of any concerns raised. And in fact, you know, it's in our interest, it's in everyone's interest to work closely together in order to meet the needs of our citizens on this front.
Thank you.
Thank you. Emma, you've got some questions around the Northern Ireland Protocol.
Yes, thanks, Convener. So obviously everybody needs to collaborate, work together, have the utmost safety of any policy is crucial. And so, but I'm curious about any impact on the Northern Ireland Protocol, because under the UK-EU withdrawal agreement, Northern Ireland will remain in the UK customs territory but remain aligned with EU regulations. So if the rules in Northern Ireland change in order to remain aligned with EU, the framework sets out the structures and processes for managing the impact of these changes. So is there could changes which result in divergence between Northern Ireland and the rest of the UK obstruct any sharing of blood, tissues or organs?
So I'd like to think not. I think that's precisely what this framework is intended to resolve, any of those concerns. So given that the framework's a four-nation agreement, it's intended to drive consistent approaches across the four nations, but it does acknowledge that there is a possibility of divergence. And it's clear for Northern Ireland that if there is a change in EU law, the law will change that will apply in Northern Ireland as well. So that will need to be considered through the framework processes. The Scottish Government set out its view that, you know, so although we are not in the same situation as Northern Ireland, but we are pretty keen as a government to remain aligned with EU law where such alignment would be appropriate and in the best interests of Scotland. So that's the reason for there being this potential within this framework to enable policy divergence between the four nations. It may well be necessary for Northern Ireland, and we may well want it for Scotland. We will, of course, through the framework process, we're able to access and seek expert advice to ensure that, you know, any decisions that are ongoing or any divergence is taken into account and to make sure that it works well. But the framework simply provides a means of discussion between the four nations.
Thank you. And if there was, I suppose, any changes or any policy divergence, we need to make sure that the communication was very clear and timely so that Scottish Government was aware of any changes that were being proposed, for instance.
So absolutely. I mean, absolutely. It is. So this framework should enable respectful communication between the four nations. It should this framework enables those discussions and that divergence to occur with respect to and respect paid to the devolution settlement. I mean, I think it is it isn't likely that there will be policy divergence or huge policy divergence in these areas, but this framework enables it, and it enables it to happen in a way where there is good communication, good understanding, and it is worked out in a respectful way between the four nations. I mean, I guess one of the things that is happening at the moment, though, is the continued pursuit of the UK internal market bill that we are seeing time and time again. You know, I think on Saturday morning, my colleague, Cabinet Secretary Agnes Robertson, was summoned to a meeting with the UK government where policy was announced that we knew nothing about. So we do see that the dialogue is often strained. This framework is intended to improve the dialogue and to ensure that each of the four nations is content with the divergence and to enable divergence should that be in the interests of any of the countries who are signed up to it.
Thank you, because ultimately this is about organ accessibility and saving lives.
Absolutely, and as I say, it's in everyone's interest that we make this work well, and thus far it has worked really well. So we have a separate NHS, we have separate legislation, we have different systems in Scotland as opposed to the rest of the UK, but we do work really closely and well on this area because it's in our shared interest to do so.
Okay. Sandesh has some questions around this.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I think we're all in agreement that collaboration across the UK for blood tissues and organs is absolutely vital. And divergence is an option in the framework. So could you give us an example of circumstances where Scotland may diverge?
So I can't think of a specific example at the moment. I think it's important that it's there because I don't have a crystal ball and I can't see into the future. I suppose one example might be, should EU law change, and Scotland generally wants to align itself with the EU. We have an intention of returning to the EU when we are an independent country. So we want to remain aligned with the EU legislation, and that might well be an area where policy divergence occurs. But I can't foresee it at the moment.
If that were to occur, Sue Webber's asked, you know, the greatest gift that somebody gives is an organ donation, and we do not want to waste it. So if we have divergence in a circumstance like that, is this a risk, or what impact might this have between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom?
So, no, it's not a risk. And I would absolutely reassure people who are giving this immense gift to help their fellow citizens that there is no risk whatsoever that this framework will prevent them from doing that. This framework will enable good cooperation, continued cooperation. We already work really well and really closely together. What this framework does is enable further cooperation and collaboration, even in the event of policy divergence. It will prevent the sort of concerns that you raise rather than contribute to them.
Carol, you want to talk about any dispute resolution mechanisms within the framework?
Yeah, I mean, it really just following on, everything does seem to be put in place to make things work quite rightly as smoothly as they can. But just to ask the Minister if there was any suggestion that any of the governments would wish to dispute anything or withdraw from the agreement, how she feels that would be protected or work, and how the Scottish Government would bring that to us here as parliamentarians within the Scottish Parliament.
So I wonder if I can ask one of my officials to come in on this. I mean, to set the ground, just to reiterate again, the whole purpose of this framework is to prevent disputes from arising. The point is to enable close collaboration between the four UK nations and to enable policy divergence, should that be a choice, and it respects the devolution settlement. So the circumstances that you describe there of dispute resolution shouldn't be necessary. The point of the framework is to prevent that from occurring. the dispute avoidance and resolution arrangements that are there are robust, though, so you would expect them to be. There are in place formal processes through the appropriate intergovernmental structures that can resolve disputes at the lowest possible level. And if that is not possible, it is then escalated up right to the point of ministers. But I'll ask one of my officials to come in and
Baker.
Thanks very much. Yeah, as the Minister says, the frameworks do set out the process for resolving disputes and have mechanisms to do so, starting with officials and then escalating to more senior officials and then to ministerial level and upwards, if necessary, to cabinet secretary level. So the aim is to make sure that any disputes about the framework can be resolved, and as the Minister said earlier, if necessary, if we couldn't reach an agreement, then we would decide to agree to disagree at that point and to diverge in terms of regulations if needed. But the aim is certainly to try and resolve any disputes and where possible to work together and ensure there's as much alignment as possible.
Thank you. Carol, do you have any more questions around this?
No, thank you.
No, thank you. I don't see anyone else wanting to ask any questions around this, so I'll bring this to a close. And I thank the Minister for her time this morning on this and the other issues that we've discussed. At our next meeting on the 8th of February, the committee will take further evidence from the Scottish Government as part of our inquiry into health and wellbeing of children and young people, and will also take evidence in two supplementary legislative consent memoranda related to the UK Health and Care Bill. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.